If you plan on spinning tires on one of these agricultural giants, you need two things: torque and horsepower. Today, we build a 400 horse powerhouse. Okay, so we've got all of our parts in for our Cummins engine project. First thing we need to do is get the crankshaft installed. We've got the cylinder block all cleaned up. Next thing to do is install the main bearings. And just like the cam bearings, make sure that the oil hole is lined up and the lock tabs on the bearing. Install the tab side first. You'll hear a snap. Now you know your bearing's seated properly. Now we're going to lubricate the bearings. It's time to fire the service truck up and set the crankshaft. All right, so next I'm going to install my thrust bearings, oil groove out. The thrust bearings control the end play of the crankshaft. It's time to install the main bearing caps. We want to make sure and keep the surface between the cap and the bearing dry, and these are marked front. Cummins recommends that you use anaerobic flange sealant on the cap flanges. It's also important to make sure you lubricate your cap bolts on the threads and on the shoulder. The oil clearance is the amount of space between the bearing and the crankshaft. That area lets the oil circulate and lubricate. Before we assemble all these caps, we have to check the oil clearance. For that, we're going to be using a tool called plastic gauge. So I'm going to cut a small piece of this plastic gauge. I'm going to set it on top of my crankshaft journal. I'm going to bolt the cap down. The bearing is going to crush this plastic gauge, and according to how wide that crushed plastic gauge is, will tell us how much clearance we have. Proper oil clearance is critical. If there's too much, your pump's not going to be able to keep up. If there's not enough, your crank's going to touch your bearing, then you're going to junk an engine. It looks like we got about 3,000 oil clearance. Good deal. The next step is to rotate the bolts at 180 degrees. Now that 180 degrees is actually going to stretch this bolt to ensure that it doesn't come loose. Every time I tighten one of these caps, the additional 180, I'm going to rotate the engine 360 degrees. That's going to tell me if there's a problem on the cap that I am working on. So we've got our crankshaft installed. Now it's time to flip this block over and install the cylinder liners. Now we're going to get these liners sealed up and get them installed into our engine block. When this is installed in your engine block, the top end of this liner is going to be surrounded by engine coolant. We need to keep that engine coolant up here and out of your crankcase. And that's where these O-rings come in. These seals are going to have to be lubricated. Just make sure and remember not to use petroleum-based lubricants. This manufacturer actually calls for vegetable oil, the same stuff that's in your kitchen. Notice on your liner you're going to have one side that has a lot more wear than the rest of them. They call that the thrust side. When you reinstall your liner, you want to rotate that liner 90 degrees. Next thing we need to do is check the liner protrusion. So what we've got to check this is a protrusion mic and some homemade cylinder liner holder downers. What we're looking for is between 7 and 14 thousandths, and we are at 10 thousandths. That's about right where we need to be. It's time to install our pistons and rods. Just keep in mind there's two types of rods, drilled and non-drilled. This is a non-drilled. If this were drilled, you would have to line up the hole in your bearing to the hole in the rod. It's time to get the rings on this piston. We've got three types of rings. We've got a compression, which would be the top ring, intermittent, which is the middle ring, and the oil ring, which is the bottom ring. Always line your ring gaps up 180 degrees apart, and never line your ring gap up with a wrist pin. Like honey on a biscuit. You'll notice there's a relief cut in the piston skirt. It's super important that you line that up with the cooling jet. If not, your piston explodes. We always install these with the crank journal at the bottom dead center. Yeah! I got a little help from my buddy Dustin. He's gonna lower the piston down as I line it up to the rod journal. Now that we've got our piston installed, I'm gonna rotate this engine 360 degrees to make sure everything's good. The next step is to install the piston cooling nozzles, and what this does is receives oil from the engine oil pump, squirts it out to the bottom of the piston to lubricate and cool it. It's important to check these for cracks. If these fail, the piston overheats, you junk the cylinder. Prime example, this engine would still be alive if it weren't for this broken nozzle. so we've assembled what's commonly known as a short block. Hopefully now we have a little more understanding where that 400 horsepower comes from. Next week, we're going to be throwing the head on this thing. We're going to stick it in that tractor. We're going to be making smoke. And as always, NewmanTractor.com. Too much, too much. You're going to have whole and holeless. You're either going to have a hole or you're not. You squat down and make me look taller than you.
No.
Go on. There.
I can't do this for long.
Liner holder downers. Liner holder downers.